Welcome to the Tough Decisions Network for Entrepreneurs. I'm Dan Hanford, and my wife, Danae, and I interview successful people sharing stories behind tough decisions that they've had to make along their journey as an entrepreneur. Before we get started, let's hear from one of our sponsors.
Hello, this is J.V. Crum III, host of the Conscious Millionaire podcast, with a special announcement for business owners, entrepreneurs, and coaches. Do you want to grow your business to reach seven figures or even multiple seven figures? Well, right now, you may have reached six figures, but you know, it's easy to get stuck or just not know which steps to take next. Frankly, that can happen to anyone. That's why this month, my special gift to you is the seven-figure formula. Now, it contains the exact steps I've used to make millions and that you need to build your own seven-figure business. Get it now as my gift to you. Go to consciousmillionaire.com/seven-figure formula. Again, go to consciousmillionaire.com/seven-figure formula.
On the podcast with us today is Andrew Sorrell. He's an entrepreneur in several different fields, including a textbook business and an upscale pawn shop, of which he just opened his second location and now running for public office in the state of Alabama. So, Andrew, thank you so much for being with us today. We know this is a busy time of life for you, so we appreciate your time and we're looking forward to talking with you.
Hey, thanks for having me on. I think it's a great thing y'all are doing these podcasts.
Andrew, I want you to first share with us, before we dive into some of these tough decisions that you've had to make as an entrepreneur, can you talk to us right now about what your current focus is right now as an entrepreneur?
Yeah, I've really got two focuses over the next year. What I'd like to do, number one, is I'd like to reduce debt. I don't want to operate at this level of debt. You know, I got married a year ago. So this past Saturday was my one-year anniversary.
And that brings out a lot of debt, Andrew, we know.
Well, I wasn't going to say that, but you know, I built a house. My wife and I are moving into our house this month. I've been living in a one-bedroom apartment the last 12 years. Although I've been a successful entrepreneur, I didn't want the upkeep of a house. So I've had more expenses, obviously, since I've gotten married. And I want to just stabilize my life. I don't want to take as much risk as I did when I was single in my 20s. So I want to reduce our debt. In fact, we'd like to pay off all of our personal debt. That's just kind of a goal we have for the next 2 years, is get completely out of debt before we try to expand any of our businesses anymore. And I'd say my second focus is automating my internet textbook company. I've got it probably about 75 to 80% automated. I'd like to get it to 95% because, as you mentioned, I'm running for public office. And if I get elected, I'll be serving in the state house. I need to be able to be away from my business for 2.5 months at a time to really properly do my job as a state representative.
And so I want you to walk us through a tough decision that you've had to make along this journey as an entrepreneur that maybe didn't have that good of an outcome or not an outcome that you had expected, and some of the lessons that you learned through that tough decision.
Well, when I was 16 years old, I started my first company. It was selling college textbooks on the internet. Perhaps not the most original idea in the world, but sometimes you can just take an existing business model and just do it better than everybody else and turn it into a successful company. You know, I've got college textbooks and pawn shops. I'm not the first person to ever try either of those. And by the way, I'm building an internet textbook company in a declining market. College textbooks are probably, at some point in the next 20 years, will be replaced by ebooks. But I got started at age 16 with this company and I had success. I mean, when I was 18 years old, I was making six figures. And I decided that I wanted to build passive income. That was my goal. So I decided what I would do is I would take the profits I had made from my internet textbook company and I would get into real estate. That was a bad decision, looking back on it. What I did is I bit off more than I could chew. And I went out, I started buying rental properties, and they were not the nicest quality, if you know what I'm saying. It did not go well. I had trouble keeping tenants. I had lots of repairs. I had people, you know, moving out of my houses, stealing my doorknobs when they went, the mirrors and everything. It was just terrible. And long story short, I basically quit doing the textbook company, just shut it down, went full time into real estate, and proceeded to lose $180,000 at age 20. Now, I didn't bankrupt or anything like that, but I mean, obviously, I lost basically everything I had made in the textbook company and more. And I should have just stayed in my lane. Just kept doing the textbooks. It was working. I was having huge success with it. Why I thought I needed to go out and try something different at that point in my life, I don't know.
What would you say, looking back, could have helped you make that decision better? Or what are some things that you might have learned through that particular situation? Because I can think of several of them, but I want to kind of know your thoughts are on that.
Well, if you have success at an early age, it makes you feel bulletproof, and you're not. I've heard it said that the more money you make, the lower your financial intelligence goes. And I think that's true. When things are going well, that's when you make your worst decisions. When things are not going well, you start really analyzing everything and making sure you're not making any mistakes. And you're kind of more of a gunslinger when everything's going well. And, you know, I think what I should have done is just saved up the money and stockpiled it. If I wanted to get into real estate, great. Go out and buy one or two houses, maybe pay cash for them. You know, it's hard to lose money in real estate when you're paying cash for it. You know, some people are successful running 5 or 10 different businesses. I don't think that's me. I think I need to focus on one or two. And I think sometimes if you're a successful entrepreneur in textbooks, that doesn't mean you're going to be a good investor in, you know, a restaurant. That doesn't mean you should go open up something you know nothing about. So just be careful what you get involved in, I guess would be my advice.
I want to dissect one thing real quick on this decision too. You said something that struck me here is, you know, when things are going well, that's when you start to make bad decisions. So, you know, what are some things that you've done that, you know, when you get to a point in your business where you're doing really well, that you kind of, you know, mitigate that risk of making bad decisions now that you've already been through that?
You build up an emergency fund, you know, just like you would do for your personal finances. Your business needs a 6-month emergency fund for operating expenses. You know, things will go wrong in your business, whether you're in a business that maybe suffered from the 2008 recession, or whether just the market just changes, things happen. And we had issues. We sell a lot of textbooks on Amazon.com. Well, Amazon changes their policies and procedures, and you got to keep on top of that. And sometimes they'll suspend your seller account until you, you know, get your account health rating back up or whatever. So sometimes you can lose all of your cash flow for months at a time, and you've got to be able to weather those storms. So, you know, build up a storehouse and keep it on hand in your business just in case something bad happens.
So you started out in the book, in the college book, you know, kind of selling business, and then you kind of shut that down when you were in your early 20s, like you said, like 20 years old,
yes,
to kind of do real estate. And are you now back into the book selling industry and kind of out of real estate?
That's correct. I'm still in real estate and I'm actually making money at it now, but I only own 4 rental properties. But once I graduated college, I started my textbook business back up. I was selling cars at the time. I had lost all my money in real estate. I took a job selling cars. And after 3 months of it, I knew it wasn't for me. So I walked in and I turned in my 2-week notice, and they told me I could just go ahead and go. And I went and I restarted my college textbook business, and I was able to pay off all of the debt that I had incurred from the bad real estate decisions. And ever since, I've been in textbooks. I mean, I was only out of it for maybe a year, year and a half, but I've started that company back up. I've built it up now. We have about $10 million in revenue and 32 employees. So
wow,
it's done
that's
very
awesome.
Well now.
That's awesome. So I want to shift a little bit here and talk about a tough decision that you've had to make as an entrepreneur that had a really good outcome and some of the lessons that you learned through that tough decision.
Sure. So in 2013, or maybe it was 2012, around that time, I was driving to Atlanta with my business partner in the textbook business. And, you know, he wanted to pay off his house. That was his goal. He wanted to, no matter what happened with our business, he wanted to say he had a paid for house. And he said, Andrew, would you be interested in buying some of my shares? Well, I really wasn't that interested at the time. But the more we talked about it, you know, he made me a relatively fair offer. I think it was going to my break even point at our current profit was maybe like 4.5 years on paying when the shares paying for themselves. It seemed like a reasonable idea. So, I mean, I really thought long and hard about that because basically it was going to take most of the profit I had made the last 3 or 4 years to buy just an additional 10% of the company. And the question was, do I want to risk everything I've made the last few years and bet on the future? Or do I just want to play it safe and just stay at, you know, 40% ownership? So I ended up deciding to go ahead with the purchase. And looking back on it, it worked out fantastic because the business has just exploded over the last few years. So now looking back, it looks like I got a real bargain. But at the time, it wasn't really a bargain. I was betting on the future, basically.
What would you say you learned through that tough decision? Like, how does that tough decision that you made, you know, cause you or allow you to make even better decisions as an entrepreneur now?
If you're going to buy more of a business that you own, you've got to believe in yourself, because what you're actually buying is a lot of your own future potential. So, and if you're buying shares from your partner, you got to realize the fewer shares your partner owns, the less motivated he is to make the company work, right? More of it shifts to you. So you really are making a purchase on your own future ability to make a profit. So, you know, you got to analyze, you know, am I willing to be committed to this business for the next 5 years to make sure that it makes this purchase worth it?
So Andrew, in your experience as an entrepreneur, which you have quite a bit of it, you know, in several different fields now, what strategies or techniques have you sort of developed to help you when you're facing a tough decision? And as entrepreneurs, we know that's something that really we do on a daily basis, but there are, you know, ones that stick out as harder than others. But what are some strategies that you use when you're facing a difficult decision?
You know, you want to pray about any difficult decision you're going to face in life. That's number one. Beyond that, you know, I now have a wife who I'm going to talk through my decisions with. I haven't ever had that until a year ago. I was blessed with a brother who is also very entrepreneurial. He started the textbook company with me. We were partners. So I guess my advice would be, don't take advice from poor people unless you want to be poor. It's amazing how many entrepreneurs ask their friends what they think about what they should do with their business. Well, their friend is a teller at a bank, and no disrespect, that's totally fine, but their friend's advice should not be followed. You want to ask people who have actually made a tough decision before as an entrepreneur what you should do. Also, don't take advice from employees. It's so funny, but so many business owners take advice from their employees. Now, I'm not talking about, an employee can have a great idea on how you can improve your business, a better way to improve a process or something like that. But if we're talking about a major decision, major financial decision, employees view things differently than entrepreneurs. And they approach most of their decisions from a safety standpoint, a job security standpoint. And that's not the way, we don't have that luxury as entrepreneurs. We inherently have to take more risk. So seek out other like-minded entrepreneurs and get advice from them. I've been blessed to get very good advice. I've got a friend up in Tennessee who owns, I think, 50 or 80 rental properties, something like that. He gave me some very good advice a few years ago.
And I think, you know, along those same lines, the biggest thing here is making sure that you surround yourself with other entrepreneurs who have made those tough decisions. And, you know, yes, it's good to have a coach and a mentor, but, you know, you don't always have to have some coach or mentor that, you know, you're paying, you know, to be able to surround yourself and network with other entrepreneurs that you can call up and, you know, when you're in the middle of a tough decision saying, hey, what are your thoughts? You know, it's very helpful to have that kind of a resource, you know, because as entrepreneurs, sometimes we get stuck in a position where we don't know who to ask questions to, and to be able to have that network of people to say, hey, you know, I'm gonna go call up X person or whatever and just say, you know, hey, here's my situation, you know, and being able to, you know, have the confidence that person's not gonna go and, you know, blab their mouth either.
Well, you're right. And, you know, they say that your income is the average of your 10 best friends' income. And that's so true. And you got to look at your 10 best friends and say, you know, do I want my 10 best friends to have an average income of, you know, 50,000 or 500,000? And I'm not saying you should pick your friends based off how much money they make. What I'm saying is you need to seek out other people who are successful entrepreneurs if you want to be a successful entrepreneur. So don't replace your old friends, but definitely, definitely make new friends.
So let's jump into a series of questions that I really enjoy on the podcast called the Trifecta. The first question is, what is your most favorite technology that you use today that helps make your business life easier?
We hired a programmer at my textbook company. And a lot of people would say, how in the world do you automate college textbooks? I mean, there's only so much ways to automate that. It's not a, you have a physical product. It's not an ebook you're selling or something like that. You'd be surprised how much of your business you can automate using technology. For instance, our algorithm does all of our purchasing. 100% of our internet purchasing, those decisions are made by a computer based on, you know, of course, it's taken us years to get it set up correctly to where it only buys the right books at the right price. We've automated our payments. When, as people sell us textbooks on the internet, we pay them by either PayPal or check. We've completely automated our PayPal payments. With one click of a button on our website, it'll pay 500 people at once. Same thing with checks. All of our checks are printed and sent out from a third-party company just through a flat, like, upload file. Right now, what we're working on is automating our pricing. So we've got the purchasing automated. Now we're trying to say, okay, what should we sell our textbook for on Amazon? You know, taking into account how old the book is, how likely this got out of edition, the sales rank, our competitors. There's so many different factors that go into pricing a textbook. We're about to have a computer making those decisions for us on how much to sell our books for.
So it sounds, you know, to me like your favorite technology is your programmer that you hired.
Well, Well, he's very good, and we have to pay him very well. But
and after he listens to this podcast, website, he's going to ask for some more money now.
Yeah, you're probably right. We do pay him a nice salary plus commission, so he's highly motivated to make our company money.
That's cool.
So, okay, go ahead, Danae.
What's a quote that has helped you in your business, maybe something that sticks out in your mind, something you think about a lot?
Yeah, there's a couple of good ones. One of my favorites is the definition of an entrepreneur, and a lot of people don't know what an entrepreneur is, but I read a very good definition of it one time, and I'll share it. An entrepreneur takes advantage of opportunities without regard to resources currently controlled. And that is so true. If you're an entrepreneur and you're presented with a great deal, you may not have $1 million to make that deal happen, but you don't even, it's like that almost doesn't even cross your mind. You're like, wow, that's a great deal. I'm going to find a way to go make that happen. You know, we were presented with a deal this January. Well, goodness, I'm building a house. I'm running for office. I don't have time to open another pawn shop this year. But literally, it was like the deal of a lifetime fell in our lap. Good, by the way, good deals never come when it's convenient for you. They always come at an inconvenient time. But anyway, we found a way to make that deal work. We found the money and we bought that pawn shop. It was a great deal. So the definition of an entrepreneur is very important. I was talking to an investor one time from California, and he got involved in the dot-com bubble. He was building up an internet company, and they had huge revenue and like no profit. And then the bubble burst, and his business partner called him and he said, okay, new strategy. Cash flow is more important than your mother. And that quote has always stuck out to me. It's so true. If you're running a small or a large company, cash flow is everything. You cannot run out of cash. It doesn't matter how much money you're making. If you have negative cash flow, you will fall apart.
Well, Dan and I've learned, I know you were talking about recently about the importance of savings or, you know, that extra in store during difficult times. But I mean, we've learned the importance of that, but also what you're talking about, you know, you have to have that ongoing cash flow. And when anything comes to hurt that, that definitely is something to look at. Do you have a book that you would recommend, something that you've read that has affected, you know, the way you approach decisions or the way that you run your business?
Oh, absolutely. Rich Dad, Poor Dad is the number one personal finance book. It will absolutely change the way that you think about money. It tells you what money is, and it tells you why everyone tries to make it in basically an inefficient manner. I'd highly recommend to everybody. I read the book when I was 18, and my brother and I had already started our college textbook company. We just happened to get a copy of Rich Dad, Poor Dad through. And my brother's like, I'm going to read this and just see what it says. He read one chapter and he came in. He said, you've got to read this book. You're not going to believe it. He gave it to me and I read it. And I read it the whole way. I mean, as soon as he handed it to me, I read the book the entire way through. It was too good to put down. And it's totally changed the way I view money and investing.
Well, Andrew, what's the next thing for you right now as an entrepreneur that's on your vision or your dream board?
Well, my goal the next 5 years, 10 years, I would like to build a chain of 10 high quality pawn shops all across North Alabama. I've got two right now. I think that's very realistic. This seems to be a good business model. It seems to be working well. I just need to pace myself and open them, try to open them with cash as the business grows. Maybe open another one, maybe one per year, something like that. I'd like to double my sales and profit at my textbook company. I think that's very doable. Really all we need to do it is a larger facility and more capital. And I'd like to begin buying some commercial real estate for long-term wealth and financial stability. I don't know if it's true, but I've heard it said that 80% of rich people either made their money in real estate or hold their wealth in real estate. There's nothing quite like real estate, and I think everybody should own some. And I'm 32. If I can buy up commercial real estate and get it on 15 or 20 year mortgages, then, you know, by the time I'm 50, I'll have paid for commercial real estate. So that's my next goals.
Well, Andrew, I want to thank you so much for taking some time out of your busy schedule to be with us today on the podcast. And how can the listeners reach out to you if they want to start to follow you more or contact you?
Well, I'm on Facebook. You can search for Andrew Sorrell in Muscle Shoals, Alabama. You could also follow my campaign page, Andrew Sorrell for State House.
Great. Well, I'll put that in the show notes as well. And that can be found at toughdecisions.net. Just search for Andrew Sorrell on the podcast page there, and he will have those links for you as well. So again, thank you so much, Andrew, for being on with us. I wish you the very best and hope that we have you on a future podcast as you continue to grow as an entrepreneur.
Hey, thanks. Really enjoyed being on.
All right. Thank you so much, Andrew. Thank you for listening to the Tough Decisions Network. Be sure to visit toughdecisions.net to gain access to show notes for this episode and to join our free weekly entrepreneur email, where we will send you news about the latest technology for your business, inspiring quotes, and the latest books for entrepreneurs. That's toughdecisions.net.